Now we're going to talk about the transport layer, specifically ports at the transport layer and what those mean and what they're for. So at the transport layer, and especially when we're talking about ports, what we're really talking about is communication, not between devices necessarily, but between applications. Because the transport layers, one of its primary purposes is to connect to applications using ports. For example, a web browser on your computer with the Apache HTTP server at Google. Now, regardless of whether Google's using Apache or not, this is just an example of a fantastic web server and a very common web server. So here, as we're talking about the transport layer and as we're talking about ports, we're talking about how Firefox on your computer is able to set up communication with Apache on Google's computer. And ports are the way that that connection happens. And they are network sockets. They are essentially what applications plug into to listen and receive communication over the network. And they're that connection point between applications and ports for both TCP and UDP. Both have their own set of ports, but the same numbers apply. And they go from 1 to 65,535. And that's because that's the biggest number you can get with 16 bits. And what that really allows, what ports allow more than anything else, is what we can call network multiplexing. Or in other words, allowing multiple applications to run on a single machine and each receive their own network communications through those ports. Because an IP address is assigned to a machine, right? So a server has an IP address, and to communicate with that server, you use that IP address. But to communicate with Apache on that server versus a database, MySQL, for example, on that server, you need to use different ports. And that's why ports are the transport layer addresses. So we've got a whole list of ports. Remember, they go from 1 to 65,535. And the lowest range, so they actually start out at 0, but you can't use port 0 for anything. So we can say they start at 1. So starting at port 0 up to 1023, those are what's called well-known ports. And you are not supposed to use those unless you are registered as an application and allowed to use those ports. Now, there's no law enforcement for using ports on the internet, and anybody can use anything they want. But typically, these ports, that first 1024, are reserved for these applications. Specifically, a lot of the ones that we've talked about, HTTP, HTTPS, DNS uses UDP port 53 primarily, SMTP uses TCP port 25. Doom, an early first-person shooter game, had multiplayer capabilities over the network, and it decided they wanted to use port 666, and so they're registered there as port 666. After the first set of ports there, there's a much wider range that are what's called registered ports. And again, and these are the ones that you should use if you want to create your own network application and have a set port. For example, MySQL uses port 2206 that falls into that range. Remote desktop, 3389. Skype uses their ports. Skype also likes to try to use port 80 and port 443 because those are very often allowed through a firewall where port 23339 may not be. Apache Tomcat and a lot of local web servers will use port 3000. And again, there's a whole list, and you can go to Wikipedia and see what services and what applications use which ports. But what's important to note is that these applications almost always use that port. Unless you hop in and specifically configure them to use a different port, they're going to be using that port. So if you want a remote desktop into a machine, the remote desktop application will automatically try to connect on port 3389. And if you've configured your server to use RDP on a different port, then you have to specify that. The same with your web browser. You don't have to specify port 80 or port 443 when you're entering in a web address because those are the defaults for HTTP and HTTPS. However, you can run a web server on any port that you want, but if you want to connect to that web server on a port other than 80 or 443, then you have to specify that when you put that in, and you specify that with a colon after the domain name. So if you want to register a port, you can register that through the IANA, And there's a whole list there. You can open up that link and check out the list of port assignments that have been registered with the IANA. And again, there's no law enforcement. You don't have to if you don't want to, but it's nice to do that and register and make sure people know what port you're using. In addition, after that 49,000 of the registered port range, there's another range, and the rest of the port spectrum from 49,152 all the way to the end are what's called dynamic or private or ephemeral ports. They kind of go by all the names. And what those are used for is a temporary source port from your PC. So when you want to connect, for example, to HTTP, to a web server on the other end, your browser needs to select a port to listen on for the return traffic, because I'm sending something to port 80, but I'm not listening on port 80 because I might want to be running a web server on the same machine. So your browser randomly or sequentially selects a port from that range, from that 49,152 to 65,535. And from that range, it selects a port to listen from. And when you send traffic, that's going to be the source port that the web server is going to return your web page to. And you can check that out in Wireshark. You'll see it, the source and the destination ports there. And the important thing about that dynamic port is that your browser will eventually stop listening on that dynamic port. So it registers itself with the operating system and says, hey, I'm listening for traffic on port 50,152, for example. And after a little while, it says, okay, I'm not waiting for traffic there anymore. And that adds a little bit of security. It means your browser is not always listening for something to come back on that port. And it prevents people from being able to send information, send traffic to your web browser that you're not requesting. So here's how it looks in the network stack. You see at the base, we've got the server, right? The hardware of the computer. We've got the data link layer. We've got the network layer where you would have an IP address for that server. And then you've got the transport layer that then connects to the different ports. And you can have multiple applications on different ports in one machine. You can only have one application per port. For example, if Apache is up and running and listening on port 80, then that's the only application that could be listening on TCP port 80. You could have a different application on UDP port 80, but TCP port 80 is then reserved for Apache. And if you want MySQL at 3306 or Bind9, a DNS service on UDP port 53, you can do that and you can have each of those. And if traffic comes in to your network that's for port 80, that this destination port is port 80, it's going to get funneled into Apache. And if traffic comes in that's destination UDP port 53, it's going to get funneled over to Bind9, and each of those applications deals with their own set of traffic. So the whole process, I guess, we can walk through the whole process. So if I want to send a web request, I want to send an HTTP request, which is on port 80, to B. And we're skipping everything below the transport layer because that doesn't matter. I'm going to select, like I said, something from that dynamic port range, a source port. And in this case, I'm using 59,012 as the example. So I'm going to create my transport layer segment with source port 59,012 and destination port 80. And that means that I am now listening for return traffic to come back. My application, my web browser, is listening for traffic to come back at 59,012, destined for port 80. When B receives the message on port 80, it'll send it to whatever application is running on port 80. In this case, we'll say it's Apache. And then it's going to send a response with the source port of port 80, because I'm B now, I'm listening on port 80, and the destination port of that dynamic port that we selected, 59,012. And when it finally gets to my machine, I'm going to receive that response on port 59,012 and send it to the application, in this case the web browser, that's listening to that port. And then once I've got the traffic that I requested, then I'm going to stop listening on that port. And then anybody else who tries to send traffic to port 59,012, that traffic's just going to get thrown away when it gets to my server. Now, if you're interested, you can actually look at what ports your computer is currently listening on. And you can do that. It's different commands. It's all well, except for Mac, it's netstat on Windows and Linux, but netstat takes different commands and there's different ways of searching for it. So the Windows command at the top, netstat-ab, you'll have to probably run that inside an administrator command prompt. So open up an administrator command prompt, run that command, and you'll be able to see what ports your computer is currently listening on, essentially what connections your computer currently has. Now, you could possibly use that to identify malware on your computer. If you look at that list and you see some applications there that are listening on ports that should not be there, then what you might have is malware. Now, what you might also have is Dropbox that you forgot about. So you can take a look at that and kind of establish a baseline of what network traffic on your computer is supposed to look like. And then later on, you can look back and look for things that are out of the ordinary. And again, these are different commands. Each operating system has their own commands and arguments to do that. And that is TCP ports. And that is the transport layer ports.